In this video, we take a quick look at how to approximate limits of a function using a calculator. So we're going to look at two famous limits as x approaches 0. The first one is sine 1 over x, and the second one is sine x over x. Neither one of these limits is algebraically obvious, so it makes sense to investigate them numerically. So just as a graphical preview of these limits, we're zooming in closer and closer to x equals 0 on each of these functions, and we're already getting a sense that sine 1 over x might be problematic. It looks like the curve just keeps getting denser and denser as we get close to x equals 0. On the other hand, sine of x all divided by x looks like it simply approaches 1 as x gets close to 0. So let's see if our numerical approach leads us to the same conclusions. So the first limit we test numerically is the limit as x goes to 0 of sine 1 over x. And to test this limit, we're going to investigate the right-handed limit and left-handed limit and see if those exist and agree with each other. So we set up our approach to 0 from the right by using a simple pattern. We're going to look at x equals 1, x equals 0.1, x equals 0.01, and so on and so on, each time zooming in by a factor of 10. Now we don't have to use these specific values, but it makes sense to choose an approach that follows a simple pattern. So moving in by a factor of 10 at each step is just really practical here. Now it's important to set your calculator in radians. As we've discussed before, radians are the so-called natural units of angle. And when we write down a trig function, we're assuming the argument is in radians. So we start to fill in our values, and we'll start with x equals 1. And this gives us the sine of 1 over 1, in other words, the sine of 1. And this comes out to about 0.841. Moving on to the next value, where x is 0.1, we get the sine of 1 divided by 0.1, which is the sine of 10. And this comes out to about -0.544. Now we'll write one more of these out, and that's the sine of 1 over 0.01, in other words, the sine of 100. And this gives us -0.506. So look what's happening to the argument of the sine function here. We started with sine of 1, and then we ended up with sine of 10, and then sine of 100. So the argument is just growing larger and larger as x gets closer to 0. And this means the sine function just continues to oscillate through many periods every time we zoom in closer. In fact, the sine function is just wiggling faster and faster as we continue to zoom. And we see as a result that the numerical values never settle down to any particular value, instead just oscillating between -1 and 1 forever. So we're going to say the limit as we approach 0 from the right does not exist. Now note that that automatically implies the ordinary limit as x goes to 0 doesn't exist, but I do want to point out what happens if we approach 0 from the left. So we're going to use the same pattern. It's just we put minus signs on all the values of x, so -1, -0.1, -0.01, and so on. And what we see in our table of values for sine 1 over x is that each of these just has their sign flipped compared to what we got in the right-handed approach. And the reason this happens is because the sine function is an odd function. If we replace its argument with the negative of the original argument, that produces a minus sign in front of the original result. And we have the same basic problem here. The closer we get to 0, the more wiggling we get in the sine function. We never settle down to a particular value, and the left-handed limit doesn't exist either. The second limit we're going to test numerically is the limit as x goes to 0 of sine x over x. And the value of this limit isn't obvious. In fact, we'll prove this limit in a later video, and I'll post a link to that video at the top when it's ready. And that proof requires some pretty sophisticated machinery. And the difficulty here is that the numerator is getting closer and closer to 0, because the sine of 0 is 0, but the denominator is also getting close to 0. So dividing by a number close to 0 makes the result larger, while the numerator is getting smaller, and we can't see an obvious result for the competition between the numerator and denominator. In fact, there's a special name for this confusion. We call it an indeterminate form. So for now, we're going to attack this limit numerically, and we're using a similar strategy here, zooming in from the right by factors of 10. And again, it's important that your calculator is set in radians for this, and we just start plugging in some numbers. So the first thing we have to calculate is the sine of 1, all divided by 1. And this time, just keeping a little extra precision, we get about 0.8415. Then we plug in our next closest value of x, and we have to compute sine 0.1 all divided by 0.1. And this gives us about 0.9983. And we continue this way. We compute sine 0.01 divided by 0.01. That gives us actually four nines in our decimal expression before we get to something that's not a nine. So we have 0.99998. And after that, there are so many nines that I've just chosen to say approximately equal to one for the rest of those values. So we're getting a pretty clear picture from this. We find out that the value of the right-sided limit of sine x over x as we approach zero is equal to one. Now, when we repeat this process from the left, plugging in x equals negative 1, negative 0.1, negative 0.01, and so on, we actually get all the same values of sine x over x. And this is because sine x over x is an even function. And that just means replacing x with negative x just yields the exact same y value. So I think it's worthwhile to just sketch a quick proof of this fact. If I replace x with negative x, then I'm looking at sine negative x over negative x. But we remember the sine function is odd, so sine negative x is negative sine of x. Now our minus signs cancel out, and I end up with the original function sine x over x. So there's no need to redo the calculations, we just get the exact same y values, and we conclude the left-handed limit is also approaching 1. Now with the left and right limits agreeing with each other, we can say the ordinary limit exists. And it turns out the limit as x goes to 0 of sine x divided by x is equal to 1. Now again, we are going to rigorously prove this limit later in the course, and I'll post a link to that video at the upper left of the end screen, and I'll see you there.